Harper Audio presents The Intelligent Investor, a book of practical counsel, revised edition, by Benjamin Graham, updated with new commentary by Jason Zweig, performed by Luke Daniels. Preface to the Fourth Edition by Warren E. Buffett. I read the first edition of this book early in 1950, when I was 19. I thought then that it was by far the best book about investing ever written. I still think it is. To invest successfully over a lifetime does not require a stratospheric IQ, unusual business insights, or inside information. What's needed is a sound intellectual framework for making decisions, and the ability to keep emotions from corroding that framework. This audiobook precisely and clearly prescribes the proper framework. You must supply the emotional discipline. If you follow the behavioral and business principles that Graham advocates, and if you pay special attention to the invaluable advice in chapters 8 and 20, you will not get a poor result from your investments. That represents more of an accomplishment than you might think. Whether you achieve outstanding results will depend on the effort and intellect you apply to your investments, as well as on the amplitudes of stock market folly that prevailed during your investing career. The sillier the market's behavior, the greater the opportunity for the business-like investor. Follow Graham and you will profit from folly rather than participate in it. To me, Ben Graham was far more than an author or a teacher. More than any other man except my father, he influenced my life. Shortly after Ben's death in 1976, I wrote the following short remembrance about him in the Financial Analyst Journal. As you listen to this audiobook, I believe you'll perceive some of the qualities I mentioned in this tribute. Benjamin Graham, 1894 through 1976. Several years ago, Ben Graham, then almost 80, expressed to a friend the thought that he hoped every day to do something foolish, something creative, and something generous. The inclusion of that first whimsical goal reflected his knack for packaging ideas in a form that avoided any overtones of sermonizing or self-importance. Although his ideas were powerful, their delivery was unfailingly gentle. Readers of this magazine need no elaboration of his achievements as measured by the standard of creativity. It is rare that the founder of a discipline does not find his work eclipsed in rather short order by successors. But over 40 years after publication of the book that brought structure and logic to a disorderly and confused activity, it is difficult to think of possible candidates for even the runner-up position in the field of security analysis. In an area where much looks foolish within weeks or months after publication, Ben's principles have remained sound, their value often enhanced and better understood in the wake of financial storms that demolished flimsier intellectual structures. His counsel of soundness brought unfailing rewards to his followers, even to those with natural abilities inferior to more gifted practitioners who stumbled while following counsels of brilliance or fashion. A remarkable aspect of Ben's dominance of his professional field was that he achieved it without that narrowness of mental activity that concentrates all effort on a single end. It was, rather, the incidental byproduct of an intellect whose breadth almost exceeded definition. Certainly, I've never met anyone with a mind of similar scope. Virtually total recall, unending fascination with new knowledge, and an ability to recast it in a form applicable to seemingly unrelated problems made exposure to his thinking in any field a delight. But his third imperative, generosity, was where he succeeded beyond all others. I knew Ben as my teacher, my employer, and my friend. In each relationship, just as with all his students, employees, and friends, there was an absolutely open-ended, no-scores-kept generosity of ideas, time, and spirit. If clarity of thinking was required, there was no better place to go. And if encouragement or counsel was needed, Ben was there. Walter Lippmann spoke of men who plant trees that other men will sit under. Ben Graham was such a man. A Note About Benjamin Graham by Jason Zweig. Who was Benjamin Graham, and why should you listen to him? Graham was not only one of the best investors who ever lived, he was also the greatest practical investment thinker of all time. Before Graham, money managers behaved much like a medieval guild, guided largely by superstition, guesswork, and arcane rituals. Graham's security analysis was the textbook that transformed this musty circle into a modern profession. And The Intelligent Investor is the first book ever to describe, for individual investors, the emotional framework and analytical tools that are essential to financial success. It remains the single best book on investing ever written for the general public. The Intelligent Investor was the first book I read when I joined Forbes magazine as a cub reporter in 1987, and I was struck by Graham's certainty that sooner or later all bull markets must end badly. That October, U.S. stocks suffered their worst one-day crash in history, and I was hooked. Today, after the wild bull market of the late 1990s and the brutal bear market that began in early 2000, The Intelligent Investor reads more prophetically than ever. Graham came by his insights the hard way, by feeling firsthand the anguish of financial loss, and by studying for decades the history and psychology of the markets. He was born Benjamin Grossbaum on May 9, 1894, in London. His father was a dealer in china dishes and figurines. The family moved to New York when Ben was a year old. At first, they lived the good life, with a maid, a cook, and a French governess on Upper Fifth Avenue. But Ben's father died in 1903. The porcelain business faltered, and the family slid haltingly into poverty. Ben's mother turned their home into a boarding house. Then, borrowing money to trade stocks on margin, she was wiped out in the crash of 1907. For the rest of his life, Ben would recall the humiliation of cashing a check for his mother and hearing the bank teller ask, "Is Dorothy Grossbaum good for $5? Fortunately, Graham won a scholarship at Columbia, where his brilliance burst into full flower. He graduated in 1914, second in his class. Before the end of Graham's final semester, three departments, English, philosophy, and mathematics, asked him to join the faculty. He was all of 20 years old. Instead of academia, Graham decided to give Wall Street a shot. He started as a clerk at a bond trading firm, soon became an analyst, then a partner, and before long was running his own investment partnership. The internet boom and bust would not have surprised Graham. In April 1919, he earned a 250% return on the first day of trading for Savold Tire, a new offering in the booming automotive business. By October, the company had been exposed as a fraud, and the stock was worthless. Graham became a master at researching stocks in microscopic, almost molecular detail. In 1925, plowing through the obscure reports filed by oil pipelines with the U.S. Interstate Commerce Commission, he learned that Northern Pipeline Company, then trading at $65 per share, held at least $80 per share in high-quality bonds. He bought the stock, pestered its managers into raising the dividend, and came away with $110 per share 3 years later. Despite a harrowing loss of nearly 70% during the great crash of 1929 through 1932, Graham survived and thrived in its aftermath, harvesting bargains from the wreckage of the bull market. There is no exact record of Graham's earliest returns, but from 1936 until he retired in 1956, his Graham Newman Corporation gained at least 14.7% annually versus 12.2% for the stock market as a whole, one of the best long-term track records on Wall Street history. How did Graham do it? Combining his extraordinary intellectual powers with profound common sense and vast experience, Graham developed his core principles, which are at least as valid today as they were during his lifetime. A stock is not just a ticker symbol or an electronic blip. It is an ownership interest in an actual business with an underlying value that does not depend on its share price. The market is a pendulum that forever swings between unsustainable optimism, which makes stocks too expensive, and unjustified pessimism, which makes them too cheap. The intelligent investor is a realist who sells to optimists and buys from pessimists. The future value of every investment is a function of its present price. The higher the price you pay, the lower your return will be. No matter how careful you are, the one risk no investor can ever eliminate is the risk of being wrong. Only by insisting on what Graham called the margin of safety, never overpaying, no matter how exciting an investment seems to be, can you minimize your odds of error. The secret to your financial success is inside yourself. If you become a critical thinker who takes no Wall Street fact on faith, and you invest with patient confidence, you can take steady advantage of even the worst bear markets. By developing your discipline and courage, you can refuse to let other people's mood swings govern your financial destiny. In the end, how your investments behave is much less important than how you behave. The goal of this revised edition of The Intelligent Investor is to apply Graham's ideas to today's financial markets while leaving his text entirely intact, with the exception of footnotes for clarification. After each of Graham's chapters, you'll find a new commentary. In these reader's guides, I've added recent examples that should show you just how relevant and how liberating Graham's principles remain today. I envy you the excitement and enlightenment of listening to Graham's masterpiece for the first time, or even the third or fourth time. Like all classics, it alters how we view the world and renews itself by educating us. And the more you listen to it, the better it gets. With Graham as your guide, you are guaranteed to become a vastly more intelligent investor. Introduction. What this audiobook expects to accomplish. The purpose of this audiobook is to supply, in a form suitable for laymen, guidance in the adoption and execution of an investment policy. Comparatively little will be said here about the technique of analyzing securities. Attention will be paid chiefly to investment principles and investors' attitudes. We shall, however, provide a number of condensed comparisons of specific securities, chiefly in pairs appearing side by side in the New York Stock Exchange list, in order to bring home in concrete fashion the important elements involved in specific choices of common stocks. But much of our space will be devoted to the historical patterns of financial markets, in some cases running back over many decades. To invest intelligently in securities, one should be forearmed with an adequate knowledge of how the various types of bonds and stocks have actually behaved under varying conditions, some of which, at least, one is likely to meet again in one's own experience. No statement is more true and better applicable to Wall Street than the famous warning of Santayana: those who do not remember the past are condemned to repeat it. Our text is directed to investors as distinguished from speculators, and our first task will be to clarify and emphasize this now all but forgotten distinction. We may say at the outset that this is not a how to make a million book. There are no sure and easy paths to riches on Wall Street or anywhere else. It may be well to point up what we have just said by a bit of financial history, especially since there's more than one moral to be drawn from it. In the climactic year 1929, John J. Raskob, a most important figure nationally as well as on Wall Street, extolled the blessings of capitalism in an article in the Ladies' Home Journal entitled, "Everybody Ought to Be Rich." His thesis was that savings of only $15 per month invested in good common stocks, with dividends reinvested, would produce an estate of $80,000 in 20 years, against total contributions of only $3,600. If the General Motors tycoon was right, This was indeed a simple road to riches. How nearly right was he? Our rough calculation, based on assumed investment in the 30 stocks making up the Dow Jones Industrial Average, DJIA, indicates that if Raskob's prescription had been followed during 1929 through 1948, the investor's holdings at the beginning of 1949 would have been worth about $8,500. This is a far cry from the great man's promise of $80,000, and it shows how little reliance can be placed on such optimistic forecasts and assurances. But as an aside, we should remark that the return actually realized by the 20-year operation would have been better than 8% compounded annually. And this despite the fact that the investor would have begun his purchases with the DJIA at 300 and ended with a valuation based on the 1948 closing level of 177. This record may be regarded as a persuasive argument for the principle of regular monthly purchases of strong common stocks through thick and thin, a program known as dollar cost averaging. Since our audiobook is not addressed to speculators, it is not meant for those who trade in the market. Most of these people are guided by charts or other largely mechanical means of determining the right moments to buy and sell. The one principle that applies to nearly all these so-called technical approaches is that one should buy because a stock or the market has gone up, and one should sell because it has declined. This is the exact opposite of sound business sense everywhere else, and it is most unlikely that it can lead to lasting success on Wall Street. In our own stock market experience and observation, extending over 50 years, we have not known a single person who has consistently or lastingly made money by thus following the market. We do not hesitate to declare that this approach is as fallacious as it is popular. We shall illustrate what we've just said, though of course this should not be taken as proof, by a later brief discussion of the famous Dow theory for trading in the stock market. Since its first publication in 1949, revisions of The Intelligent Investor have appeared at intervals of approximately 5 years. In updating the current version, we shall have to deal with quite a number of new developments since the 1965 edition was written. These include 1. An unprecedented advance in the interest rate on high-grade bonds. 2. A fall of about 35% in the price level of leading common stocks, ending in May 1970. This was the highest percentage decline in some 30 years. Countless issues of lower quality had a much larger shrinkage. 3. A persistent inflation of wholesale and consumers' prices, which gained momentum even in the face of a decline of general business in 1970. 4. The rapid development of conglomerate companies, franchise operations, and other relative novelties in business and finance. These include a number of tricky devices such as letter stock, proliferation of stock option warrants, misleading names, use of foreign banks, and others. 5. Bankruptcy of our largest railroad, excessive short and long-term debt of many formerly strongly entrenched companies, and even a disturbing problem of solvency among Wall Street houses. 6. The advent of the performance vogue in the management of investment funds, including some bank-operated trust funds, with disquieting results. These phenomena will have our careful consideration, and some will require changes in conclusions and emphasis from our previous edition. The underlying principles of sound investment should not alter from decade to decade, but the application of these principles must be adapted to significant changes in the financial mechanisms and climate. The last statement was put to the test during the writing of the present edition, the first draft of which was finished in January 1971. At that time, the DJIA was in a strong recovery from its 1970 low of 632 and was advancing.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.